Good evening and welcome to Dr. Martin Sherman's lecture. Tonight's lecture is part of a series of lectures to promote the idea of the application of Israeli sovereignty over Judea and Samaria. Ladies and gentlemen, after 46 years of Israeli rule over Israel's biblical heartland and homeland, we have not yet succeeded in making it clear that this land is ours. The world only hears about Jews who talk about constantly about giving away land. The Oslo agreements, the Y agreements, the Geneva Accords, the disengagement, the Y agreement. And we ask, where is the plan by the national camp that says loud and clear, Eretz Israel le'am Israel, the land of Israel belongs to the people of Israel. The application of Israeli sovereignty is the answer to that question. And tonight, we will hear Dr. Martin Sherman and his views on the topic. Dr. Martin Sherman served for 7 years in operational capacities in the Israeli defense establishment. He was an advisor to Yitzhak Shamir's government and lectured for 20 years at the Tel Aviv University in political science, international relations, and strategic studies. He's the author of different books and numerous articles, which we enjoy every week in the Jerusalem Post also, and policy papers on a wide range of political and security issues, and currently is involved in establishing the Israel Institute of Strategic Studies. Dr. Martin Sherman, bevakasha.
Good evening to everybody, and thank you for such a large crowd. Of course, I must thank the organizers, Nadia and Judith, for making this event possible. I'd also like to mention my director of operations, Malcolm Dash, who couldn't come as he's not feeling well, but he also had a hand in organizing this event. So thank you very much for coming. This could be a long evening. It's not easy in a short number of sound bites to convey a convincing counter paradigm to an idea that has gripped the discourse for years. And in presenting the lecture and the presentation this evening, I always had to decide between entertaining and education. And I normally come down on the side of educating, or at least trying to educate, because I think the information and the ideas that I want to convey this evening are important. And you're probably unlikely to hear them elsewhere. I put a lot of thought into how to present this evening because I realize that this is probably an audience that is more involved and better informed than some of the audiences I speak to in English. So I've changed slightly the presentation that I normally give under this name, Reassessing Palestine, what Sherlock Holmes would have said, which is normally a very structured presentation, long, with about 120 slides. And I've taken some of them out with some trepidation because very often it's important not only what you say but how you say it. But I'm going to count on the fact that people here probably know some of the things that I've taken out. I have, however, retained quite a considerable portion of it because the original presentation was aimed at, first of all, debunking the two-state solution and then presenting an alternative. And today, the two-state solution is still a very ominous prospect on the horizon. In fact, as I'll mention later, perhaps even more ominous than it ever was. Of course, negating other alternatives helps in validating your own. And why I say that the two-state solution is becoming more ominous than it was before, because although it's being disproven as a means for attaining peace, it is now acquiring a status of a value in its own. the two-state solution, even though it doesn't bring peace. And you can see this being pushed at the academic or the intellectual level by the Institute for National Security Studies, INSS, which had their conference at the end of April, and on the public level by Blue and White Future, headed by Gilad Shear and Ami Ayalon. And if you read today's newspaper, you'll see that this is starting to infiltrate into the government, because the people involved with promoting that idea of unilateral, unrequited the establishment of a Palestinian state influence greatly people close to the Prime Minister. Well, up until now, one of the most withering criticisms at the left wing, what I like to call the dovish and the dove-hawk divide rather than left and right, but for convenience we'll call it left and right. One of the most withering criticisms that the left wing has had vis-a-vis the right wing is, what's your alternative? And the right wing has been very unassertive and very inarticulate in proposing a comprehensive and coherent alternative to the two-state. And whilst people have been very articulate in criticizing the two-state solution, like for instance Bogi Yaalon, they've never actually come up with a comprehensive and cogent alternative. That's something I'd like to address in the third part of my lecture here. What's changed lately is that on the right wing now, some alternatives are being raised. I don't want to be too confrontational with some of my right-wing colleagues, but in many ways, as perhaps we can discuss later during question time, I think some of the alternatives being raised are no less dangerous and perhaps even more dangerous than the two-state solution. Of course, what I'm going to present here cuts sharply across the grain of conventional wisdom and diverges significantly from political correctness, but I believe that it adheres very closely to factual correctness. I'm one of the rapidly diminishing people who aren't afraid to say that they're an Israeli patriot and who believes strongly in the necessity and the justice of the resurrection of Jewish self-determination. But this does not mean that this undermines my ability to function as a professional political scientist. In fact, I'm probably one of the few people who believe that political science is not an oxymoron. And I think that my analysis and my conclusion are the results of the application of the principles of political science and international relations to what's known as a conflict. And what I want to do is present a viable political algorithm, which, if implemented, will bring about the desired results. And I think that sets it apart from some of the other proposals being brought forward by some people on the right wing. Perhaps the only arbitrary issue, or the arbitrary aspect of my presentation, will be its point of departure. I believe that Israel should be, and continue to be, in the long run, the nation state of the Jewish people. Now that's an arbitrary assumption, because if you forego that assumption, then many other possibilities are feasible. However, with all due immodesty, I will assert that if that is your point of departure, what I'm suggesting is the only alternative. So, let's begin. By the way, please note, as we go through the presentation, you'll see that I say very little myself. All I do is quote left-wing or Arab sources and connect the dots. Okay, now, just let me test the audience and see actually how well-informed we are. Have a look at this quote. The permanent solution for the Palestinian problem will be less than a state. In other words, rejection of the two-state solution. We will not return to the 67 borders. And these are the elements of the permanent solution. First of all, united Jerusalem under Israeli sovereignty with Male Adumim, Givat Ze'ev, etc., etc. The security border of the state of Israel will be the Jordan Valley. And the borders will include Gush Etzion, Efrat, Beitar, and other communities, most of which are in the area east of what was the Green Line prior to the Six-Day War. The establishment of new blocks of settlements in Judea and Samaria, note the terminology Judea and Samaria, like Gush Katif. Who said that and when? How many? Who said that and when? How many people say Rabin? Yeah, well, that's more than the average audience, by the way. But as you can see, it's probably less than a quarter. Okay, that was Yitzhak Rabin's last speech. Yitzhak Rabin's last speech in the Knesset. That's the Rabin heritage. That's Rabin's heritage. Now, if Bibi Netanyahu were to embrace that word for word today, he would be dismissed as an unrealistic extremist. So, the point of departure of my lecture is the following quote from The Sign of the Fall from Sherlock Holmes. When you've eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. Okay? Because there's no really obvious solution here. So first what you have to do is eliminate the impossible under the assumption that your point of departure is Israel should continue to be the nation state of the Jewish people. Okay, so what we're going to try and do is identify the impossible on two levels. What's impossible in terms of Israeli security, and what's impossible in terms of Palestinian political aspirations and competence. Then what we're going to do is, once we've established what's impossible, will be to explore the improbable, which must be the truth. So, what Israel cannot do, what Israel should not do, and what Israel must do. So, let's start off with identifying the impossible in terms of Israeli security. Now, one of the first clues that our sleuth Sherlock Holmes would come across is the following prediction, which foresaw with chilling accuracy what would happen almost four decades ago, what would happen if Israel adopted the policy that it has adopted. The establishment of such a Palestinian state means the inflow of combat-ready Palestinian forces, more than 25,000 men under arms, into Judea and Samaria. Notice the terminology, Judea and Samaria. This force, together with local youth, will double itself in short time. Almost exactly correct in the numbers. Then the prophecy went on. It will not be short of weapons or other military equipment. In a short space of time, infrastructure for waging war will be set up in Judea and Samaria and the Gaza Strip. Israel will have problems in preserving day-to-day security, which may drive the country into war, as it has several times, or undermine the morale of its citizens. In times of war, the frontier of the Palestinian state will constitute an excellent staging point for mobile forces, which, by the way, was the article that Yuval Steinitz wrote that started his political career in commentary. In times of war, the frontiers of the Palestinian state will constitute an excellent staging point for mobile forces to mount attacks on infrastructure installations vital for Israel's existence, to impede the freedom of action of the Israeli Air Force in the skies over Israel, and to cause bloodshed among the population in areas adjacent to the frontier line. Who said that? Well, I think you'll find that no more remarkable than the accuracy of the prediction of the prophecy was the identity of the prophet. And there's a book that you should get your hands on, which hasn't been translated into English, called Ke'et Machal, Tomorrow is Now, which was published in 1987 after the Labour Party lost the elections and Peres was trying to re-establish his status as a national leader. 78, yeah. Ke'et Machal, the name's in Hebrew. So the next thing Sherlock Holmes might find of interest is this map. As you can see, it's marked secret, and it's stamped by General Earl Wheeler, who was head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the U.S. Armed Forces. How many people know about this map? Look at that. Okay? Now, that is a massive indictment. The fact that only 4 or 5 people know about it is a massive indictment of Israel's public diplomacy. Because everybody interested in Israeli affairs should know about this map. Everybody interested to know about whether you agree with it, whether you think it's relevant, whether it's not relevant, but people should know about it. Why? Sorry?
In which year?
I'll get to it. Here's an article written by Eugene Rostow. Eugene Rostow was, of course, the dean of the School of Law at Yale. He was also Under Secretary of State and a senior American diplomat involved in the formulation of 242, who knew exactly what was meant by the document. And what did he say in this article, which was published, by the way, which was published in 1993, the same year that the Oslo agreements were signed. What does Eugene Rostow say? What these two senators, he was arguing with two senators, Byrd and Dole, assume, is that somehow or other, some Arab state has the right to claim that anything beyond the Green Line is Arab territory under 242 and 338. This is exactly contrary to its provisions and purposes. I repeat, this is exactly contrary to its position, to its provisions and purposes. There is an important document which has now been released. It is useful in interpreting the resolution 242 because it reveals in part what the US government had in mind in pushing the resolution through. It is a map of the area showing places of particular security concern to Israel. The map was prepared by the Joint Chiefs of Staff, who made a study of the Israeli security, who advised the President on security of what the security concerns of Israel were. The President was President Johnson. The study advised the security of Israel required Israel to receive part of the territory of the West Bank as essential to its defense. In fact, all the studies of the Israeli security problem reached the same conclusion. From the security point of view, Israel must hold the high points in the West Bank and along the Jordan River. And then he says something very important. I do not know if the Joint Chiefs of Staff would draw a different map today, but I doubt it very much. Okay?
Where was this published?
It hasn't been published. Yes. That's the whole point. It's only been published surreptitiously. First of all, what happened, it was published for a short period of time, then the State Department clamped down on it, and eventually it was one article in the Jerusalem Post. But this should be on the front burner of the foreign ministry. You know, people say, well, you've now got three or four ministries dealing with public diplomacy. You've got the foreign ministry, you've got the ministry for information and public diplomacy, you've got the ministry for international affairs, but no one's pushing this. Now, this might be a bit superfluous for the crowd here, but just let's go through it quickly. Why is the term Greater Israel so misleading? Well, if you compare it to the larger countries of the world, that's Greater Israel. And then, if you compare it to the Muslim world, you can see why land for peace is rather a perplexing concept because it requires the Arabs to give something they have very little of, i.e. peace, in fact getting less and less peace, for something they have a great deal of, i.e. land. It's sort of, structurally it doesn't make sense. Now, never mind geography, it's not even a matter of geography, it's a matter of topography. Okay? So, what is the topography? This is the area, as you probably all know, the area designated for the Palestinian state. As you can see, it's an elevated area overlooking the densely populated coastal plain. By the way, some maps here that were sent by Mark Langford that people can take. Okay, so you can see 12.5 miles to Tel Aviv, 4 miles to Petah Tikva, Ben Gurion Airport, about 4 miles, etc., etc. What does this mean? Okay, in cross section, this is what it looks like. Anyone who controls the highlands here. Anyone who controls the highlands here controls, first of all, the approaches from the east. I'm going through this very quickly because if it was a day-long seminar, we could divide it into 3 sessions and we could talk more into greater detail about the military implications. But as you can see, anyone who controls the highlands here controls the heavily populated coastal plain and the approaches towards the east. Now, what would a Palestinian intelligence officer see from the highlands? Okay, let's suppose he was standing here. That is the area of Chomish, the community destroyed during the 2005. During the 2005 disengagement, which was not only from Gaza, but also from northern Samaria. So what would our Palestinian intelligence officer see through his binoculars? The power station, the Khadera power station, that's this area about there. This is the Caesarea power station. That's what it looks like at sunset. Maybe we can turn the lights down slightly. Now, if our intelligence officer would take his binoculars and move a little south, what would he see? You could see the terminal at Ben Gurion Airport and the main runway. There you can see a plane on the runway. Sorry? Oh, that's a bit much. It was a bit too much. Yeah, what was it? That's better, yeah. Okay. A plane on the runway. There you can see it taking off. Okay. This by the way was photographed by my son-in-law with a civilian camera from the water tower of Farim. So, which is east, by the way. The interesting thing in the photograph is you can see these buildings here. These are the buildings. These buildings here are the buildings of an Arab village called Rantis, which, so in other words, this was taken well within the Palestinian territory. Yeah, this is the long corridor from passport control to the duty free. Okay, you can almost see the labels on the whiskey bottles. Okay, but by the way, just imagine a billboard campaign like this, where people in Tel Aviv traffic jams would have to see these.
Is this area, is that Arab village and area in BRC?
I don't know if it's BRC or Rantis and Laboon, I'm not quite sure.
A or B?
It's A or B. But here you have the Azraeli towers. There you have the diamond exchange, and there you have Ehud Barak's apartment. So in other words, the Palestinian intelligence officer could actually see the former Minister of Defense apartment from deep within Palestinian territory. What are these guys smoking? There you can see the Reading power station, all from within you can see there, yeah, you can see the village well. Care of towers, etc., etc. Now, what makes this so disturbing is what our leaders once said. For instance, going back to Shimon Peres, even if the Palestinians agree that they have their state, that their state have no army or weapons, who can guarantee that a Palestinian army would not be mustered later to encamp at the gates of Jerusalem and the approaches to the lowlands? And if a Palestinian state were unarmed, i.e. demilitarized, how would it block terrorist acts perpetrated by extremists, fundamentalists, and irredentists? That's a good question. Maybe at the next presidential conference, people should ask him that question. And by the way, you can see this was in his book, The New Middle East, published in 1993. There's the approaches to the lowlands. Now, Shimon Peres going back to his former book, it is of course doubtful whether territorial expanse can provide absolute deterrence. However, the lack of minimal territorial expanse places a country in a position of an absolute lack of deterrence. This in itself constitutes almost compulsive temptation to attack it from all directions. Now, in the 20th century, with the development of the rapid mobility of armies and the defensive importance of territorial expanse has increased. Without a border which affords security, a country is doomed to destruction. So here Peres himself, of course, explodes the myth that in the days of modern weaponry, territory is no longer important. because he himself acknowledges that the greater firepower, the greater range, and the greater mobility makes territory more important than it used to be, because you need greater areas to deploy, you need greater areas to maneuver. Territory has become more important because of modern weaponry. In 1948, it may have been possible to defend the thin waste of Israel's most populated area when the most formidable weapons used by both sides was the cannon of limited mobility and limited firepower. If a Palestinian state is established, it will be armed to the teeth. Within it, there will be bases of the most extreme terrorist forces who will be equipped with anti-tank and anti-aircraft shoulder-launched rockets, which will endanger not only random passers-by, but every airplane, helicopter taking off in the skies, and every vehicle traveling along the major traffic routes in the coastal plain. And that was before they built Highway 6. And even Amnon Rubinstein, who was Minister of Education for the far left Meretz, once said, the proponents of a Palestinian state claim if they, the Arabs, threaten us with artillery from Qalqilya, we will threaten Qalqilya with our artillery. However, the answer to this is very simple. The Arab world can exist, prosper, and develop not only if our artillery threatens Qalqilya, but even if it hits it. Israel, small and exposed, will neither be able to exist nor prosper if its urban centers and its vulnerable airport and its narrow winding roads are shelled. There's the vulnerable airport. This is the fundamental difference between them and us. This is the terrible danger involved in the establishment of a third independent sovereign state between us and the Jordan River. A third state is liable to be an arrowhead directed at the very heart of Israel with all the force of the Arab world behind it. Amnon Rubinstein, Meretz. And even the iconic Yigal Alon, in an article in Foreign Affairs, wrote, the innovation and sophistication in weaponry, including the appearance of ground-to-ground missiles and supersonic fighter bombers, not only failed to diminish the value of strategic depth in their natural barriers, but in fact enhanced their importance. This is even more true for Israel's difficult geographic position. And then he talks about the asymmetry of the conflict. One does not have to be a military expert to easily identify the critical defects of the armistice lines that existed in the 67. For Israel, a military defeat would mean the physical extinction of a large part of its population and the political elimination of a Jewish state. To lose a single war is to lose everything. And that's why we have to err on the side of caution, because there's no room for error. Even more true for Israel's difficult geographic position. And then he talks about the asymmetry of the conflict. One does not have to be a military expert to easily identify the critical defects of the armistice lines that existed in the 67. For Israel, a military defeat would mean the physical extinction of a large part of its population and the political elimination of a Jewish state. To lose a single war is to lose everything. And that's why we have to err on the side of caution, because there's no room for error. Now, going quickly through the elements of Israeli defense doctrine, just a few minutes, just very quickly. The Israeli defense doctrine is comprised of three components. In Hebrew, they sound a bit better than in English. Deterrence, early warning, and decisive victory. Hartaah, hartaah, v'achaah. That sounds very simple. By the way, there's people are still writing about these. Very recently, the INSS, the what used to be the Jaffe Center, produced documents referring to these three elements. But what do you need for early warning? You need to collect the intelligence. You need to assess the intelligence. You need to draw conclusions, hopefully the right ones from the intelligence, and then make decisions, hopefully the correct ones. So what looked very simple before, now it's much more complicated, and that is not an instantaneous process. So, if you need to react, remember the distances. Remember the distances we were talking about before. And so, what you need is somewhere to block an invasion or an enemy. If we're talking about a conventional military scenario, which at the moment is not such an ominous danger. But if you expose yourself to one, it might be. So where do you block? Whilst you must remember that the Israeli Defense Force is based mainly, or to a large degree, apart from the Air Force, on reserves. Best case scenario, you need something like between 60 hours to mobilize them, get them to the military to the military camps, equip them, convert them from civilians to soldiers. All that takes time, and so whilst that is happening, the standing army, composed mainly of 18-year-olds with thin shirts, need to hold up what might be a superior invading force. And where do you want them to hold them up? In the topographically superior positions or the topographically inferior ones? So the only place you can really get them, you can really stop them, is on the highlands of Judea and Samaria, which are cut by a very few traversing axes, which gives you enough time to hold up large forces with small forces once while your reserves are being mobilized. Now, the issue of long-range missiles makes this even more critical, because if missiles are fired and there's damage and soldiers want to take their families out of the populated areas to the Negev before they go to the bases, instead of the mobilization taking something like 48, 60 hours, it might take 100 hours. And so the standing army will have to confront an invading force for longer without reinforcements. That's why the topographical positions are even more important. Very quickly, an issue which is often overlooked and not well understood is the water issue. Again, I'm going over this very, very quickly. This is a page from a book I wrote on the topic. The grey areas are areas that are across the green line, which are critical from a hydrological point of view. In other words, either any pumping or pollution in these areas can dramatically affect the pumping areas within Israel. Now, of course, large-scale desalination has somewhat changed the situation in the last few years, but it has not eliminated it. This is still a critical area, and these are the Palestinian pumping sites. So you can see even a small withdrawal would leave the control of the aquifer in Palestinian hands. And by the way, if you don't give it to them, then they have no real access to water themselves. And so it was Uri Sagi, who later became, who was head of intelligence and later became the head of Mokorot, the Israeli water utility, who said that the Arabs demand 60% of Israeli water in any peace agreement. That includes the Golan, by the way. That's just to show you how sensitive the area is from the point of view of the supply of water. So what would withdrawal from this area mean? It would mean all the major airfields, civilian and military, would be exposed, major seaports and naval bases, principal power stations, as we've seen, the sweet water system, crucial communications and transport system, including rail and road, vital centers of military command and control and centers of civilian government, and 80% of the population and 80% of the economic activity would be in range of weapons being used today from territory relinquished to Arab control. So this is no longer be dismissed as right-wing scaremongering. This is the
Hezbollah?
Well, Hezbollah as well, but not only. All these would be in range from the same kind of rocket capacity that you have in Gaza, if that was transferred to Judea and Samaria. Okay, so this is no longer right-wing scaremongering. This is the empirical precedent. And so territorial concessions would be a multidimensional threat. Length in terms of the extent of the frontiers, width, there'd be no strategic depth, there'd be in terms of height, topographical inferiority, and in terms of depth, hydrological dependency. So whatever you do, your position deteriorates dramatically. And so you can see why All the studies of Israeli security problem reach the same conclusion. From the security point of view, Israel must hold the high points in the West Bank and along the Jordan River. And so we reach a situation where the retention of defensible borders by Israel implies that a Palestinian state is untenable. Or alternatively, the establishment of a tenable Palestinian state means that Israel will have indefensible borders. And so, nearly 2 decades ago?
14.
No. Sorry?
14 years
ago, a very astute analyst of the Middle Eastern affairs pointed out that the structure of the bargain that needs to be struck between Israel and the Arabs seems inherently irresolvable. For whatever appears to be even minimally adequate for Israel seems to be totally inadequate for the Arabs. And so it was quite gratifying to see almost a decade later the head of the National Security Council said virtually the same thing. Gyora Island, the maximum that any government of Israel will be ready to offer the Palestinians is much less than the minimum that any Palestinian leader can accept. And that's the impasse.
He plagiarized it from you.
And so when I say at the beginning what we must understand, what's impossible for Israeli security, I more or less rest my case here. Now, identifying Palestinian political competence and what's impossible in terms of that. Now, here I should imagine there are no avid advocates of the two-state solution here, so this warning sign is probably a little bit superfluous. So the question that two-state solution advocates must be forced to confront is why a Palestinian state hasn't been established up to now. Why has that been established up to now? Because if you look at the history of national liberation movements, the movement that had the least chance of success was probably the Zionist movement, the Jewish national movement, and which achieved the most remarkable success. The movement had the best chance of success, was probably the Palestinian movement, and has achieved the most miserable results. Okay? So, if we look at Palestinian deeds and declarations, we are forced to ask a question. Do Palestinians really deserve a state? And some audiences, I really have to explain what I mean by deserve, because I'm not putting my value judgment on them. I mean they failed the test of history. And do the Palestinians really desire a state? These are two questions that have to be forced into the discourse. Well, have a look at the left-leaning Sefer Plotzker. The Palestinians, if the Palestinians really wanted a state, they would have established it long ago. The Palestinians prefer a state of no state, no responsibility, no commitments, no solution, and ongoing terror. Had Rabin and Peres not dragged the PLO leadership to the Oslo, it would not have initiated anything by itself. And here's an interesting quote from Lawrence of Arabia in a letter to the Times in 1920. He says, merit is no qualification for freedom, i.e. for independence. Freedom is enjoyed when you are so well armed, or so turbulent, or inhabit a country so thorny that the expense of your neighbors occupying you is greater than the profit. Okay, so what's he saying here? Is to be independent, the only test is success. But surely then, the only test of not deserving independence is failure. And continuing decades of failure of Palestinians to acquire independence must disqualify them at some stage. So do the Palestinians really deserve a state? Well, and this is a phrase that has to be injected resolutely into the debate. They have failed the test of history. Why? Because the Palestinians have enjoyed almost universal international endorsements of their claims, a highly supportive international media coverage, decades of superpower patronage. I remind you that there was a stage during the Soviet Union, and the Soviet Union was still around, there were more officers representing the PLO around the world than there were Israeli embassies. Enormous international financial aid, and highly accommodative Israeli regimes, which not only acknowledged but identified with their claims and built their political careers on that identification. And in spite of that, the Palestinians have totally failed. to establish any semblance of a stable, productive civil society. Under the Fatah, they've set up a corrupt kleptocracy. Newsweek, something's rotten in Palestine. People in the West Bank are angry at Israel, but their fury may turn to another target, Arafat's government, completely corrupt. Or a tyrannical theocracy under Hamas, Times Online, or chronic chaos under both. And it was even the rather dovish Ephraim Alevi, who said the Palestinians are proving, have not yet proved their capacity for nationhood. A nation has to be built from within. The Palestinians are not creating their own nation. They're being pushed by outside sources. A Palestinian nation is being built with outside help. I think this cannot succeed. Hardly a hawk. Now, do Palestinians really desire a state? There are two hypotheses for this. That the conflict is fueled by a lack of Palestinian self-determination, and what the Palestinians really aspire for is to establish a state for themselves. That's a conventional wisdom. But there's alternative wisdom which holds that the conflict is fueled by the existence of a Jewish state, of Jewish self-determination, and the Palestinians aspire not to establish a state for themselves, but to dismantle a state for others. And that's what drives the Palestinians. So the Palestinians, if you can prove that the second hypothesis is correct, then basically the Palestinians are not a nation seeking self-determination. They're an anti-nation seeking to negate the sovereignty of someone else. So I suppose many people know this quote from Zaya Mohsen, who used to be head of the SAIKA and was on the Palestinian, the PLO Central Committee, until he was dispatched to the next world by the Mossad. There are no differences between Jordanians, Palestinians, Syrians, and Lebanese. We're all part of one nation. It is only for political reasons that we carefully underline our Palestinian identity, because it is in the interest of the Arabs to encourage a separate Palestinian identity. In other words, it's an Arab thing. Yes, the existence of a Palestinian identity serves only tactical purposes. The founding of a Palestinian state is a new tool in the continuing battle against Israel. I should argue with him. By the way, I spent a weekend in a luxurious villa over Sofia in Bulgaria, where we met some Palestinian leaders. There was Mamdouh Nofal from the Democratic Front, and someone from who was then Yusuf Ihya. Yusuf Ihya, who was one of Dahlan's people, and one of the Khalidis from Oxford. And they said, well, of course, Zaya Mohsen would say that he was a Syrian stooge. But Farouk Kaddoumi can't be accused of being a Syrian stooge. And he said exactly the same thing, almost exactly the same time, just with less words. Jordanians and Palestinians are considered by the PLO as one people. And even King Hussein, at the Arab League conference in Amman, said the appearance of a Palestinian national personality comes as an answer to Israel's claim that Palestine is Jewish, from which we are forced to acknowledge that if there'd been no Jewish claim to Palestine, there would be no Palestinian national identity. So it's all a giant hoax. But I think perhaps most damning is what the Palestinians themselves write in their national charter. The Palestinian people are part of the Arab nation. However, at the present stage of their struggle, they must safeguard their identity. How many other nations do you know who say they must safeguard their identity for the present stage? The Italians, the Greeks, the Brazilians, who? Only the Palestinians say they guard their identity for the present. In other words, it's a giant hoax, they admit it. But where's our public diplomacy? Now, do people want to hear the original video?
אני לא חושב שיש אומה ערבית. אני תמיד חשבתי ככה, ואני גם לא כשניתי את לדעתי אני לא חושב שיש פלסטיניאן ניישן, אני חושב שזה המצאה קולוניאלית, פלסטיניאן ניישן. מתי היו פלסטינים כזה, מה... אני עוד לא הפכתי, למרות המאבקי הנחרץ בכיבוש, לא הפכתי ללאומן פלסטיני אף פעם. אני חושב שפלסטין עד לסוף המאה ה-19 הייתה דרום סוריה הגדולה.
Quite amazing. That's Azmi Bashara, who was a self-described Palestinian. He was an Israeli Knesset member, part of the Bon Ton's social strata here, until he was forced to flee the country because of suspicions of treason in helping the Hezbollah during the 2006 Lebanese War. So basically, for the people who couldn't understand the Hebrew, you can see the English translation on the screen.
It was Menachem Begin who created the Palestinian nation.
Well, the many things. Menachem Begin also created the Jihadi Emirate that's forming in Sinai as well. So here we have a Severprotska. They don't want a state. And in the Atlantic, Robert Kepler, a very strange article, but he also says the Palestinians don't really want a state. And so we have these two hypotheses. The one that the conflict is fueled by the lack of Palestinian self-determination and that the Palestinians do not, and the Palestinians aspire to establish a state for themselves. And the second is that the conflict is fueled by the existence of Jewish self-determination, not the lack of Palestinian self-determination, and that the Palestinians aspire to dismantle a state for others rather than to establish a state for themselves. Now, which of these two hypotheses has the greatest explanatory power? Well, there are a whole lot of facts, and because I want to get onto some other things, I'm not going to spend too much time on these. But if you look at these facts, that every territorial proposal which could have allowed them to have a state has been rejected, the rhetoric and their symbolism show that there's, that the whole of the territory between the Jordan River and the Palestinian state is Arab territory. That they rejected Barak's very generous proposal, because perhaps the only really intelligent thing that Barak did during his tenure was inject the issue end of conflict, and that's something that they could not accept, because they're not looking for a state; they're looking to dismantle a state. And of course, the right of return, which really tears the mask off Palestinian intentions, because if on the one hand you claim to reach an agreement with you, you must remove Israeli administration over Palestinians across the Green Line, but in the same breath you say that to reach an agreement with us, you must allow hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of Palestinians this side of the Green Line to live under Israeli administration. This really is completely inconsistent with any fair-minded approach to two states for two people. So just very quickly, if you look at the symbolism, you can see no place for Israel. These are the Islamic organizations. It was not all that surprising. But if you look at the Palestinians, the so-called secular ones, the Palestinian Liberation, the Fatah, which is sometimes confused, but it's a different organization. The Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, set up by George Chabash, by the way, a Christian, and later by Ahmad Sadat, who was responsible for the assassination of Zevi, of Gandhi. If you look at the Popular Front of the Liberation of Palestine General Command, which was set up by Ahmed Jibril, who broke away from Chabash because he wasn't extreme enough. And then the Democratic Front for the Liberation of Palestine, which was responsible for the Maalot massacre, if people remember, by Naif Khawatmi, was also a Christian, by the way. There were many leading Palestinian terrorists, like Wadi al-Khadad as well, who were not Muslim. And again, the declaration, this is still on the United Nations site, the United Nations Observer site of the Palestinians, on their site today, okay? The partition of Palestine in 1947 and the establishment of the State of Israel are entirely illegal. The partition in 1947, regardless of the passage of time, that doesn't matter what you do, doesn't matter how much time goes by, that's illegal. And that's still on the United Nations site today. Now, I think the interesting thing here is that the Palestinians refrained from designating Judea and Samaria as a Palestinian homeland up until Israel moved in. Because if you look at the original formulation of the Palestinian Charter, you will see that they claim that they do not exercise any sovereign claims over Judea and Samaria and Gaza, and they even say that the West Bank is part of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan in their national charter. Because if you remember, just before the Six-Day War, Shukeri, who was Arafat's predecessor, talked about liberating the homeland. What homeland was that? Okay, so which hypothesis should we adopt as a basis of theory? The alternative hypothesis, which claims that what fuels the conflict is the existence of Jewish self-determination and the Palestinians aspire to dismantle a state, which can explain nearly everything we've discussed, or the hypothesis which explains nothing, which claims that the Palestinians want to establish a state for themselves. So that's the question that we have to ask ourselves. Okay, so basically, if you remember, the first two parts of the lecture were, one, what's impossible in terms? Israel has tried to solve this conflict in a number of ways. First of all, it's offered limited autonomy. It's offered extended autonomy. It's offered negotiated sovereignty. It's offered unilateral withdrawal. Okay, and none of these have really worked, so let's have a look now at other solutions. Because that failed, that was Camp David 1, that was Rabin before, the pre-Oslo Rabin, that was Oslo and its derivatives, you remember there was Tenet, etc., etc. Unilateral withdrawal, Lebanon, Samaria, and Gaza. And so that failed, and that failed, and that failed, and that failed. So what about other solutions? What would you look for in other solutions? Okay. So let's make a distinction between tactical and strategic. And I would say we should say the strategic, a tactical involves devising ways to contend with or to manage undesirable existing realities. Whereas strategic involves devising ways to attain a desired future reality. Okay? And I have a feeling that most alternatives that are being proposed for the two-state solution are tactical, because they how to manage existing realities. They do not posit a desired reality, and this is how do we reach it. So what would we look for in our desired reality? First of all, we want to avoid long contorted borders, which I think, for instance, annexing C will not achieve. Okay, if you look at C, that's C. Look at the borders. You know, if you want a challenge, try and measure them. Okay, and you have to measure them, and you have to delineate them. You have to measure them, and you have to delineate them, and you have to secure them. Otherwise, there's no meaning to sovereignty, because how do you delineate between the territory that you have sovereignty over and that you don't if you can't secure the border of it? So the next thing is to avoid topographical inferiority or vulnerability, which you might think about if you want to offer people mountainous emirates that overlook the coastal plain. And then you want to avoid the large presence of incompatible and else potentially fractious socioeconomic ethnic groups, i.e. the Arabs here, which you might want to think about if you're going to promote leaving them there and giving them citizenship, which some people are promoting. So Jewish survival, if you go back to my point of departure, Israel's survival as a nation state of the Jewish people requires addressing two imperatives, the demographic imperative and the geographic imperative. In addressing these two imperatives, it faces two mortal dangers, the two-state solution and the one-state solution. The two-state solution does not address the geographic imperatives as we've seen. The one-state solution doesn't address the demographic imperative, because it doesn't really matter if you can gerrymander the borders and find that you can actually somehow concoct some ways that the Arab vote won't give them majority. The point is how you deal socioeconomically and culturally with this massive new population that will suck up all your budget requirements for raising them up to even the level of Israeli Arabs. So what's the major challenge of Zionism today? If you compare Iran versus Palestine, the Iranian nuclear threat might endanger the physical existence of the state, but the Palestinian issue endangers the very conceptual legitimacy of the Zionist project, because it undermines our deterrence, because we're prevented from using our military prowess. It creates a demonization of Israel. It's very divisive within the Israeli society, and as I said, it delegitimizes the entire Zionist project. In fact, if you want to know how much it delegitimizes, have a look at this. Do a Google search. This is a couple of months ago. Do a Google search on the right of various countries to exist. If you do it, you'll see that most countries, there are very few hits. Okay, Mexico, Brazil, Lithuania, etc., etc. If you Google Israel's right to exist, you get nearly 7 million hits. Nearly 7 million hits. If you do a Google search on how many sites deal with the right of different countries to exist, okay, so you'll see Israel's very right to exist is a hot topic. It's no longer something that we can take for granted, or is not taken for granted internationally. And that's all can be traced back to the Palestinian issue. The greatest challenge that the Zionist enterprise has today, and it doesn't matter what solution you adopt, whether you accept mine or anyone else's, unless you delegitimize the Palestinian narrative, no other solution is possible. That has to be the major focus of national endeavor. And of course, the Palestinians, it shouldn't be that difficult, because the Palestinians are giving you all the ammunition you need themselves. So, that's a whole different lecture how to do that, okay? But let's suppose you have to remove the Palestinian issue from the issue of Palestinian statehood from the international agenda, and you delegitimize the Palestinian narrative that fuels the demand for Palestinian nation. That's the imperative, and let's suppose you can do it. But that doesn't solve the problem. Because, by the way, first of all, before we go into that, to do that, and what's not being done today, is that you have to present the Palestinians as they really are. And that's why we're losing the battle. Because if you insist, as Israeli officialdom does, to present the Palestinians as cuddly poodles, when they're really vicious Rottweilers, no one understands why you need Rottweiler policy to deal with poodles. So unless you present the Palestinians as they really are, there's no way that you can delegitimize their narrative. And I can give you a lot of stories about that as well, but that's the crux of the matter. But even if you manage to remove the issue of Palestinian statehood from the international agenda, this still leaves the issue of the Palestinian humanitarian plight. And this is something that has to be dealt with. So I'm going to suggest now a tripartite initiative, which has elements which I think no other proposal has. First of all, to depoliticize the context. Second, to atomize the implementation. And thirdly, and most important, it obviates the need to reach an agreement with any Arab collective. You don't have to have an opposite number, a collective opposite number. So what do I mean by depoliticize the situation? First of all, you have to reformulate the problem in humanitarian rather than the political terms. And I'm going to suggest three steps which can be, I always have trouble talking to Americans because they don't speak English. libertarian tenets of the. What I mean by libertarian is what Americans mean libertarian. I mean liberal, politically correct. Okay. First of all, the elimination of the discrimination in the treatment of Palestinians on two levels, and the facilitation of the freedom of choice for individual Palestinians. Now, who can object to that? Who can object to that? First of all, let's start off with the elimination of discrimination in the treatment of Palestinians at two levels. First of all, as refugees, and secondly, as residents in Arab countries. Now, starting off with eliminating discrimination against the Palestinians as refugees, this calls for the elimination of UNRWA. Now, if you disagree with everything I've said up to now, by the way, this is important in approaching the problem, because you can't approach the Palestinian problem with tunnel vision. You can't just look at the Palestinians living in Judea and Samaria and Gaza. You have to look at the huge overhang of the Palestinian diaspora. And that's the key to the problem. That's the key to the problem. Because if you disagree with everything that I've said up to now, and you disagree with everything that I say after I speak about UNRWA, UNRWA itself is a standalone issue. And if you manage to deal correctly with the UNRWA, everything else will fall into place.
But this is a utopia.
Sorry? No, it's not utopia. It's not utopia. I'll tell you why not. First of all, what do you mean by refugees? I mean, I suppose most people know that there are two organizations that deal with refugees in the world. Nearly all the refugees on the face of the globe are under the auspices of an organization called the UN High Commission for Refugees. They deal with all the refugees on the face of the world, whether it's tsunamis or earthquakes or political persecution or famine, etc., etc. The Palestinians have their own organization which deals only with the Palestinians. By the way, it's supposed to do with Jewish refugees from the conflict, just that they're none. And these two organizations have different definitions and different mandates. Who's a Palestinian, defining who's a Palestinian, and how to deal with them. The universal definition of Palestinian, of so the universal definition of refugees, which is the High Commission definition, means that the number of refugees decreases over time. With the UNRWA definition, the number of refugees balloons over time. According to the High Commission definition, which is valid for, as I said, all the refugees on the face of the globe except the Palestinians, you can find permanent solution for refugees in third-party countries, not necessarily their country of origin. For the UNRWA definition, all you can do is take care of the humanitarian needs. So if you take the UNRWA definition and the UNRWA mandate, which generates a situation where you have an expanding population and all you can do is take care of the humanitarian needs, you reach a conclusion that UNRWA is an organization that perpetuates the problem that it's supposed to solve. And unless you deal with that, there will be no solution, not one state solution, or two state solution, or eight state solutions, no solution. That is the first thing that you have to deal with. Now, by the way, Canada stops funding them for precisely these reasons, and Israel was asking them to reinstate their financing. Because the biggest obstacle to dealing with UNRWA is the Israeli Foreign Ministry. I gave a lecture several years ago in the Knesset, a subcommittee on UNRWA, and my biggest opponents were the Israeli Foreign Ministry sitting opposite me saying, well, UNRWA's not the enemy. UNRWA is the enemy, even when at that time they had a nice Scandinavian woman at the head. And this is becoming something that more and more people are beginning to realize. There are more and more articles being written about it. And this is something, by the way, that cuts across left and right. Because more and more left-wing people are beginning to realize that even for a two-state solution, if you don't want Israel to be flooded with refugees, you have to get rid of UNRWA. So this is a quote from Scott Lesansky, who won the Yitzhak Rabin Shimon Peres Peace Prize at Tel Aviv University, obviously not a hardline right-wing hawk. The current situation, particularly the deliverance of international assistance to UNRWA, is untenable and does nothing to contribute to an eventual settlement. And even Tom Lantis, the late Tom Lantis, Democrat, talked about this as well. But you can find quote after quote after quote from people who are not on the hardline right wings who are beginning to realize that unless you do something with UNRWA, no solution is possible. And even Einat Wilf, who was in the Ehud Barak's party, did quite a lot of work in Congress with it. Now, this is not just an Israeli problem. Because if humanity decides that X amount of resources should be allotted to deal with refugees in the world, why should one group of refugees have an expanding slice of the cake and all the rest a decreasing slice of the cake? It just doesn't make sense. And this is something that if Israel made a resolute push for, it would resonate hugely in Congress. Hugely in Congress. And if America cuts their funding and Canada cuts their funding, because the Arabs don't fund them. If you look, the major funders of UNRWA, all European nations, and the Japanese. By the way, after I gave elections, there was a discussion of UNRWA in the Japanese Parliament. But there's no follow up here. There's no follow up here, and the political establishment here is worse than useless. And okay, so let's suppose in an ideal world you manage to get rid of UNRWA and all the Arabs, all the Palestinians living in the Arab world are not getting their anomalous handouts. What do you do next? There must be a resolute diplomatic offensive to stop the ethnic discrimination against Palestinians in the Arab world. This is a quote from the Los Angeles Times by Hisham Yusuf, who was then the spokesman for the Arab League, who acknowledged that the Palestinians in the Arab world had a difficult time. He said, if every Palestinian who sought refuge in a certain country were integrated and accommodated in that country, there won't be any reason for them to return to Palestine. Precisely. And that's the point. They are being held as pawns. So people who are protecting Palestinian nationalism most zealously are not the Palestinians. They're the other Arabs, as we'll see a little bit later. So you must understand that there is huge ethnic discrimination against Palestinians in the Arab world. In fact, several years ago, now must be about 5 or 6 years now, there was legislation in Saudi Arabia which made it easier for non-Saudis to acquire citizenship of the kingdom than it was before, which was available to all the nationalities in the world except the Palestinians. And by the way, across the Arab world, there's discrimination as far as employment opportunities, ownership of assets, freedom of movement, etc., etc. And here's a report from Haaretz, which discussed the roadblocks in Lebanon, which were much longer than stringent, and residents now have to spend at least half a day at the entrance of the respective camps when they leave and return. Not a single presence of women in black there. Abu Mazen set off another bomb in a television interview. He requested that the Arab states grant citizenship to Palestinians living within their borders. So even Abu Mazen agrees with me. Okay? Leading Arab television stations conducted opinion polls, which more than 80% of the respondents said that this would, granting them citizenship, because now they're no longer getting handouts from UNRWA, remember, would spell the death knell for the right of return. Precisely. But when Palestinians were interviewed, the vast majority of them wanted to become citizens of the country of residence. So basically what we're doing is pushing for a policy that is consistent with the wishes of the Palestinians. What could be more compliant than that? Okay, and the well-known Palestinian pollster Khalil Shkaki had his office trashed because he found that Palestinians didn't want the right of return. They wanted to get on with their lives. Refugees are human beings with needs. These people want to live their lives. They're no longer interested in being national standard bearers. So all that I'm suggesting in the second component of my tripartite proposal is to comply with Palestinian wishes in the Arab world. Now comes the hot potato. Well, okay, but can I just leave questions to the end? I'll answer it later.
Questions at the end.
Yeah. So now comes in brackets where they're living at the moment. Yeah. But anyway, but let's get on. Now comes the hot potato, the third part The third part of the proposal, the facilitation of freedom of choice for individual Palestinians. And what I'm suggesting now is offering the Palestinians generous relocation loans individually, not as a collective, because the most counterproductive thing that the present government is doing is supporting the PA. Let it collapse. Let it collapse. But don't leave the Palestinians to suffer. Offer them a way out. Offer them relocation loans, because they've been betrayed by the cruel, corrupt cliques that have ruled them for 4 years. Let's offer them a way out. We're not leaving them to suffer the consequences of the collapse of the Palestinian Authority. We're letting them find better lives for themselves and their families on an individual basis, not as a collective. So we have to atomize the offer and offer it directly to individual breadwinners and family heads. Now, this may be rejected at a collective level, but let's analyze it at an individual level. If you're an individual level who has the choice of either continuing the rigors of life under Israeli control, or life under the even more repressive and more regressive Palestinian regime, or getting a bunch of money, more than he can ever dream of earning, and building himself a better life elsewhere, surely that's the rational decision at the individual level. Now, some people say, well, they'll never accept this. This is utopia. Well, I beg to differ. I did a survey a few years ago, I admit, but there have been other surveys that support it later. This is a genuine survey conducted by Magal Mohot, which is a very reputable polling company in Israel, together with a Palestinian counterpart. And the interesting thing they found, that only 15% of the Palestinians said they would reject any material compensation to immigrate permanently. Over 70% mentioned something, whether it was better housing, better employment, better education, that would induce them to leave permanently. Now, I'm not saying this is etched in stone, but this is much more convincing than some unsubstantiated declaration, what they'll never leave. Why wouldn't they leave? What are they going to look for? But the point is, we'll get back to that. Ask me that a bit later, okay?
Very soon we're getting to the questions.
So here you can see there are more opinion polls which show that significant numbers of Palestinians would leave if they were offered want to leave even without it. By the way, the Bill Zait survey showed that almost half the youth and over half the male youth would leave if they were given the opportunity. And all I'm saying is, give them the opportunity. Now, this is a proposal that has impeccable liberal credentials. Here you have the quote from the great humanitarian Herbert Hoover, who said, "Consideration should be given even to the heroic remedy of transfer of populations. The hardship of moving is great, but it is less than the constant suffering of minorities and the constant recurrence of war." Who disagrees with that? Who disagrees with that? No, they have to be confronted with it. And Andrei Sakharov said, "With all the money that has been invested in the problem of the Palestinians, it would have been possible long ago to resettle them and provide them with good lives in Arab countries, or other countries, by the way. There are 500,000 Palestinians living in South America." And Scott Lisensky, we saw before, and wrote a book with Daniel Kurtzer. "The collapse of the Oslo process and the ever-worsening Israeli-Palestinian violence demonstrates that certain long-held truths about the conflict need to be turned on their heads. The U.S. should launch an international initiative that provide for economic support for refugees in neighboring states, including host governments, and provide for incentive packages for the repatriation of non-neighboring states, including the West." So people thinking about this certainly got on the hard ring wide. And even Yossi Bailey said the EU should absorb Palestinian refugees. Now, what about the cost? First of all, let me say about the cost. The cost in many ways, the absolute cost, is in many ways irrelevant. Why irrelevant? Because the alternatives are not free either. So it's not how much you actually need to spend on it is in itself not the main issue. The question is, how much will it cost to set up a Palestinian state, a failed micro mini state that's going to become a forward base for Islamic terror, set up the infrastructure, which probably won't be sustained anyway. So what's important here is the relative cost, and the relative cost is something that has to be calculated. But it would only be a fraction of the outlay that the U.S. spent on two useless wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. If you look at this graph, it's quite amazing. 90%, and in Afghanistan it's worse, 90% of the cost of $1 trillion almost was spent after Saddam Hussein was captured and after the Taliban was dislodged. Nearly 90% of $1 trillion is spent on what? $90 trillion is much more than you need to resettle all the Palestinians in Beverly Hills. On what? What, I'm trying to set up democracy on the banks of the Euphrates and the slopes of the Toro Boro? What were these people thinking? Now, I can go through the cost with you. It depends on who you believe, the CIA or Yoram Ettinger, about how many Palestinians. I tend to believe Yoram, by the way. But it doesn't really matter, because even if you believe the CIA, the costs are not exorbitant. It would be something like, I should imagine, top level $200 billion. $200 billion over a decade and a half is something that Israel could shoulder itself. Israel has a GDP today of $250 billion. Okay, $250 billion. If it were to allot between 7-8% of GDP each year for repatriating Palestinians without any international help, it could shoulder most of the burden itself within a decade and a half. So you don't have to put all the Palestinians on a train in the same year, or a ship or a boat or whatever it is in the same year, and ship them out. No, it's an osmotic process, but it's something that keeps moving. And the important thing is that's your diplomatic defense. What you have to do is break the monopoly of the two-state solution over the discourse, or the one-state solution as the necessary default. You have to have another alternative whilst you're doing this. So $200 billion, even if Israel had to shoulder the burden itself for a decade and a half, would not cripple it. There are various reasons. So let's have a look at this. This is why I call this a win-win situation. First of all, it would alleviate, even eliminate, the humanitarian plight of individual Palestinians. It would ensure the continued security and survival of Israel as the nation state of the Jewish people. Provide a significant boost to the economy of the developing world. Because remember, Palestinians who come to a developing country are not coming as impoverished refugees. They're coming as reasonably wealthy emigres. Let me give you an unrealistic but illustrative example. If all the Palestinians decided they wanted to go to Indonesia, the largest Muslim country in the world, and Indonesia decided it would accept them, what would be the result of this, apart from the fact that Israel would not have to give up vital strategic assets? It would mean that each Palestinian would be arriving at the gates of Indonesia with something like 70 years of Indonesian GDP in his pocket, the equivalent of someone arriving in America with $2 to $3 million. The Indonesian economy would have, by the way, it would be an increase of 1% of the Indonesian economy if they absorbed all the Palestinians. And the Indonesian economy would get a boost of between $100 and $200 billion, depending on how much compensation you were thinking of. Who loses, apart from the Palestinian leadership? Doesn't that sound like win-win to you? And, of course, transform the poverty-stricken refugees into affluent emigres. So people say, well, it's not feasible. First of all, feasibility is the worst argument that you can bring up. Because first of all, what do you mean? What doesn't matter if it's feasible. First of all, it matters if it makes sense, so you can use it as a political weapon against the two-state solution. But feasibility? Is the two-state solution feasible? If your point of departure is that Israel should be the nation-state of the Jewish people, the infeasibility of the two-state solution as a method for reaching a peace hasn't prevented anyone from discussing it for two decades. So at least, as something that needs to be discussed, this should be put on the agenda. Okay. So, but if you look at territorial compromise, the offer after offer has been rejected. So as Einstein, who said that doing the same thing over and over again is expecting different results, is insanity. And there was George Santayana who said, redoubling your efforts, having lost sight of the objective, is the definition of fanaticism. So we're left to decide whether territorial compromise is insane fanaticism or fanatical insanity. So, but on the other hand, the relocation and rehabilitation of the Palestinians, which would improve the situation of individual recipients, improve the economies of the host countries at acceptable economic cost, sounds a much more feasible alternative, at least to be discussed. At least to be discussed and to break the monopoly of the two-state solution over the discourse. And towards the end, it was Amnon Rubinstein who wrote an article in the Haaretz when, it's almost impossible to believe, he wrote an article in the Haaretz and said, of all the Palestinian lies, there's no lie more crushing than that which calls for the establishment of a separate Palestinian state in the West Bank. Not since the time of Dr. Goebbels, the head of the Nazi propaganda machine, has there ever been a case in which the continued repetition of a lie has borne such great fruits. Okay, so one wonders when this dramatic transformation occurred with Rubinstein, where this crushing Nazi-like lie formed into the shiny truth which guides his path. And then there was a poem by Nathan Altman, my translation. And then Satan said unto himself, this besieged foe, how is to be overcome? Both courage and skill are his. He is well armed and well alert. And then said Satan, not his strength shall I sap, nor bridle and muzzle shall I place on him, nor fear shall I bring into his heart, nor cause him to be weak as he once was. All I shall do is this, his mind shall I dull, and make him forget that righteousness is with him. And that's the problem, we've forgotten who the good guys are. And this, of course, would be a good point to stop. However, we must go back to Sherlock Holmes. And when you have eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. And so we've limited autonomy, we've tried and extended autonomy, and negotiated autonomy and unilateral withdrawal. And so there must be some other solutions. So what would Sherlock Holmes have said about reframing the Palestinian problem in humanitarian rather than political terms? Elementary, my dear Watson.